So Enzo Vernon is our presenter tonight. He's going to dig into reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning is definitely coming up a lot more frequently for us now in the deep learning meetup. And I actually just created, if you're familiar with AWS Game Days, I just created a reinforcement learning game. So I'll get the URL for you, but if the name of the game is Oats or Die, it's a very simple game. And if you've ever done a game day at AWS, these things can be really, really fun, and they really hone your knowledge in a number of areas. So we're doing a machine learning game day. If you want to go to that repo and try it out and you have comments, do a pull request, I'd be more than happy to get your feedback on that. So that's just to underline the value of reinforcement learning. And with that, Enzo, I'm going to stop talking. I think we've got a quorum on our team here, and I'm going to hand it over to you.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Chris. And let me just share my screen and we'll get started. Can everyone hear me perfectly?
Yes. Yeah, or coming well? Through loud.
Perfect. Well, I want to start off by thanking everyone for coming. I especially want to thank Chris again for hosting this technical session. My name is Enzo Vernon, and today I'm going to define reinforcement learning, cover why it's important, explain how it differs from the branches of machine learning, delve into the concepts behind this exciting field of AI, and then conclude with a few demos. I do want to stress that the opinions are my own and not necessarily a reflection of my employer's attitudes towards reinforcement learning, which I'll routinely refer to as RL. I also ask that all questions be reserved for the Q&A session at the end because we have a lot of content to cover. So what is RL exactly? In its simplest form, reinforcement learning are goal-oriented algorithms that learn to achieve their goals on their own through trial and error. An easy comparison is to visualize a child learning to walk by trying to take 10 steps forward without falling toward its mother for a hug. The child repeats this process until it learns to walk. Now, a crucial question to ask is, why should we care about it? In business, RL will be able to analyze customer behaviors, tailor ads to customer interests, and then dynamically adjust prices to maximize revenue. It will revolutionize transportation with autonomous vehicles, but most importantly, it can craft personalized treatment strategies for clinical patients. The key takeaway is that RL can do wonders for personalization, the practice of tailoring a service to accommodate specific needs. Now, you may wonder, how does RL differ from supervised learning and unsupervised learning? In supervised learning, you have an algorithm, which is referred to as a model, taking a very large data set as input with target outputs known as labels, and the model tries to learn the relationship between the two. This is called classification. Unsupervised learning takes in a very large data set as well, but it doesn't have these target labels. It tries to identify the relationships through data clustering and anomaly detection. Similar to supervised learning, RL is classification as well, but the data set is continuous and dynamic. The inputs are states of being, and the outputs are possible action values. An RL model learns how to behave by trying out different possibilities in a dynamic environment where any number of events can occur. Over time, the model will identify an optimal set of actions and exploit that strategy to achieve its goal. In order to understand how an RL model chooses the best action, though, we first have to get comfortable with certain key terms and concepts. The agent is the entity that takes the actions. In this case, our agent is Wall-E from the Pixar movie. Actions are a set of possible moves the agent can make in the environment. The environment is the world that the agent moves through. In mind that an environment doesn't necessarily have to be a physical environment. The environment takes in an agent's action as input and returns its reward and next state as output. The states are the circumstances that the agent finds itself in. An episode, which is just an iteration in RL slang, starts at an initial state and moves to subsequent states with each action taken until it reaches a terminal state. For example, one lap around a track would be considered one episode of the environment. The model is the agent's current understanding of the environment. A model's predicted values can both improve or depreciate over time. The value function refers to the expected long-term return of a given action or state. The state transition probability describes the likelihood an agent will take a specific action to move into a specific state based on the current state's value and a future state's expected value. An agent is able to gauge a future state's value through the exploration of its environment by initially taking random actions. Over time, the agent will have to decide how often it takes random actions versus trained actions. This is known as the action selection policy. Simply put, the policy is how an agent chooses its actions. The optimal policy is a set of actions that complete the goal and yield the highest rewards. The reward is the environment's feedback to the agent for each action taken that allows us to measure the immediate value of an action and also the long-term value of an action or state. A reward can have a positive, negative, or neutral connotation. For these reasons, the agent will have a better understanding of each state's value in subsequent episodes. Moving forward, I'm going to refer to Wally as our agent, ending with Eve as our goal. Now that we know the terminology, we're going to deep dive into the concepts that make up this exciting field of AI. First, we're going to demystify how Wally calculates the state of being by learning about the Bellman equation. Then we're going to enhance this equation by adding randomness to it. We'll eventually discuss how time factors into the equation L when we touch on temporal differences. The framework Wally's going to use to make decisions is called the Markov decision processes, commonly abbreviated as MDP. MDP and the Bellman equation serve as the foundation for all reinforcement learning policies. Now, there are many strategies Wally can employ to achieve his goal in RL. One of the strategies that we're going to focus on today is called DQ learning, which uses artificial neural networks to predict the actions with the highest value. So what is the Bellman equation? Developed by Richard Bellman, an applied American mathematician, the Bellman equation is a recursive equation that allows us to get the current value if we know the same value at a future point. Functionally, it's a means of optimization. In terms of the state value function, the value of a given state equals the action with a maximum value out of all the possible actions in the given state. Now, the value of the action equals the reward for getting in the next state plus the discount factor times the value of the next state. Simply put, Wally is going to anticipate what it's going to be like for every step towards Eve. I want to draw attention to the fact that this illustration depicts the use of the Bellman equation in a deterministic scenario, meaning that there is 100% probability of which actions are taken. I've decided to introduce this concept in this manner for simplicity's sake. We'll gradually scale the complexity. The discount factor, commonly represented by the Greek symbol gamma, has a value of 0.8 in the illustration. And it's a way to incentivize Wally to be closer to E. It means that a state that is farther away from the goal has inherently less value. This is also known as discounting rewards. In the illustration, the reward equals zero for every state except for Eve's state with a plus one and the fire pit with a negative one. Standardizing values between negative one and one, or zero and one, which is known as normalization, makes our calculations in RL considerably easier. Now imagine that there is a plant, with a reward value of, 0.3 in the state above Wally, and it increases the likelihood of him being with Eve. Wally takes the action to move up and is rewarded with that plant. The value of the state that Wally came from would proportionally increase to the value of the plant. This is why the state next to Eve has a value of 1. Once Wally does reach Eve, though, the environment will return a terminal state boolean to indicate the end of the episode and prompt Wally to assess the sum of his rewards. To reiterate, the Bellman equation is an optimization function that allows Wally to chart a path for himself in order for him to achieve his goal. We're now going to add randomness to Wally's environment, which is known as the Markov property in probability theory, named after Russian mathematician Andrei Markov. The game Ms. Pac-Man is a great example of this theory because the ghosts represent randomness in the environment that force Ms. Pac-Man to calculate her state of being. The key issue is, how does Ms. Pac-Man know that a state that she's transitioning to is better or worse than another potential state in a dynamic environment? The state transition probability that we discussed earlier heavily influences the value of a given state. By taking this into account, the agent has switched to a non-deterministic mode, meaning that its actions are now a matter of probabilities to counter a dynamic environment. That said, the agent will still have to explore the environment by initially taking random actions to approximate current and future state values. I'm alluding to the action selection policy, and a popular variant of this is known as the epsilon greedy approach. The RL terms epsilon and stochastic more or less mean random. Under an epsilon greedy action selection policy, Wally is going to start off by taking 100% random actions and over time exponentially take more trained actions until he reaches a defined epsilon minimum. Now, it's important to always set an epsilon minimum, which is the minimum probability of random actions taken, because we never want Wally to completely stop exploring and potentially learning in a stochastic environment that may have anomalies. Strategies to adapt to a stochastic environment use a decision-making framework called the Markov decision processes, which utilize states, actions, and rewards to achieve a goal. These values can be optimized with the Bellman equation. Since we don't really know what the value of the next state will be due to randomness, the value of the next state in the Bellman equation becomes the average slash weighted sum of all potential next states based on all possible actions in the current state. The probability of Wally transitioning to a potential state is now weighted differently, which adjusts over time. Instead of focusing on an agent's state of being, though, we're not going to shift our focus to the quality of its actions. This is known as Q-learning, which is an action value function. We're simply reframing the Bellman equation in terms of current and future actions instead of states. The first step in transitioning into or going from a state value Bellman equation to Q-learning is to switch from deterministic to non-deterministic like we discussed. This includes rewriting the equation to account for the probability that is the Markov property. Next, we're going to reframe the Bellman equation to focus on the Q values. Now, if a Q value is just the value of an action, which we had previously defined as the reward plus the discount factor times the weighted sum of all potential next states, and the value of a state equals the action with the maximum value out of all the possible actions in the given state, then we could infer that the Q value of a given action equals the reward plus the discount factor times the weighted sum of all potential actions in the next state. Each potential action is a maximum Q value recursively. So in the illustration, Wally is going to evaluate the actions he can take from his current state. When he evaluates the action of moving up, he's also going to evaluate the actions he can take from the next state as well. He'll notice that by taking a right from the next state, he's going to be with Eve, which is going to return the reward with a maximum value. The Q value of moving up from his current state will take all of this into account, which is why, Wally takes this action. We're now going to account for time. Things change over time, including inverse, which means that the quality of an action changes as well. This is referred to as temporal differences. Q learning is a type of temporal difference learning, where an agent can learn at any given time step in an episode. Within the context of RL, a time step is just a fancy way of saying an action taken. The temporal difference is the essence of Q learning because it allows Wally to gauge if the action he just took, which he predicted to be the best in that state, is an accurate assessment. By tracking the value of an action across episodes or update cycles, and considering the implications of the immediate action against the tracked value of the same action in the given state. That was a lot of information packed into a single sentence. So let's break it down. So here is the Q value of the immediate action, a reward plus the discount factor times the maximum Q value in the next state. And here is our previous Q value of the same action in the given state. I want to point out that we're deliberately omitting the probability when calculating the temporal difference because we already know which actions were taken. So when Wally takes an action, he's going to compare the result of that action, the immediate Q value, against his expected target result, the previous Q value, which he has stored to memory. Calculating the difference between these two Q values will allow Wally to understand how the quality of a given action has changed over time, the temporal difference. In the next equation, the learning rate, commonly represented by the Greek symbol alpha, is the normalized rate at which Wally learns to adapt. We're going to multiply the temporal difference and the learning rate together, take that product, and then add it to the previous Q value to adjust it and ultimately get a new target Q value, meaning that Wally will be able to incrementally adapt to his stochastic environment that potentially has anomalies. Now, if you set the learn rate to 1, then your two previous Q values will cancel each other out, and your new target Q value will always equal your immediate Q value. This is a bad idea because we don't want Wally to dismiss the wisdom of his past experiences in a stochastic environment that potentially has anomalies. Conversely, if you set the learning rate to equal 0, then your new target Q value will always equal your previous Q value, which manifests into an absence of learning. In other words, a predetermined Wally is going to take the same set of actions over and over and again, expecting different results that always lead to success regardless of his circumstances. According to Einstein, that is the definition of insanity. Generally speaking, we want the learning rate to be small, like 0.0001, because we want Wally to learn, but we don't want him to act erratically or drastically to any changes in his environment that might end up being an anomaly. This dynamic can be visualized into a graph known as gradient descent. Gradient descent charts the trajectory of prediction accuracy. The lowest point in gradient descent is known as the global minimum, and it correlates with the action with the or the prediction or action with the highest accuracy. Now, there can be other valleys in gradient descent, and those are known as local minimums. We never want our model to be in a local minimum because that means our model's predictions are suboptimal. Now, if the learning rate is too large of a value, then it's possible that your model actually overestimates the global minimum, overshoots it, and ends up settling on a suboptimal prediction. This is a symptom of underfitting because the model has lost some of the data granularity it uses to consistently make accurate inferences. That said, if the learning rate is excessively small, then the time it takes to train a model becomes painfully long, potentially costing an unnecessary amount of money and resources. I want to emphasize that having an excessively small learning rate doesn't necessarily guarantee success either. There are other hyperparameters at play, like batch size, and you could simply just have a bad model. Not only that, but having an excessively small learning rate can actually lead to misleading success known as overfitting, which is when a model becomes so accustomed to the training data set that it is incapable of making accurate inferences on production data it's never seen. The point being, we want to find that sweet spot between speed and accuracy. This all comes into play when Wally chooses the best action based on the Q values. Now that we have a fundamental understanding of how Q learning works, we're going to use artificial neural networks to predict the actions with the highest quality. This is referred to as deep Q learning. We use artificial neural networks because it speeds up the time it takes to find these optimized values via gradient descent. Now, a neural network has three main components: an input layer, hidden layers, and an output layer. A neural network first layer takes in an array of standardized inputs. As we all know, it's important to always pre-process your inputs into an efficient and uniform format, or the model won't be able to make sense of the data. Each input goes in each hidden layer neuron, where they're summed, and an activation function, commonly a rectifier, sigmoid, or hyperbolic tangent function, identifies a unique relationship between the inputs and then decides on the importance of that relationship to the next neuron. The relationships represented by these blue lines are called weights. In technical terms, the activation function is a linear regression that investigates the correlation between a dependent target and multiple independent predictor variables, like the weights. The weights represent the slope, meaning our output y equals the slope w plus or times the summed input x plus the y-intercept b. Since we're standardizing our values, the y-intercept would always be set to zero. In practice, we're tracking the summed inputs commonly within the thresholds of negative 1 to 1, or 0 and positive infinity, and the accuracy adjustment, which is a derivative of the prediction accuracy in gradient descent, is being applied to the weights, effectively updating them. Updating weights are how a neural network learns to make better predictions. This is a crucial concept to understand because a neural network can have multiple hidden layers that refine the weights between the inputs and the outputs, hence the term deep. Since all weights are interconnected, you have to proportionally update all of them. If you have a very deep neural network, then the gradient that's being applied to the weights becomes proportionally smaller for each layer back. Eventually, the gradient will become so small that it won't be able to adequately update the weights of the layers at the beginning. meaning that our weights that crescendo to the predictions are ultimately predicated on untrained layers near the origin. This is what we call a vanishing gradient problem. Now, there are several ways to resolve this issue per neural network type, but the most popular and straightforward is to use a ReLU activation function, the rectifier function, on the hidden layer neurons. And that just means return X if X is greater than zero, else return zero. The neurons in the output layer, aka the target labels, are the neural network's final set of predictions. The activation function in the output layer is commonly a softmax function, which organizes these predictions into a valid distribution of 100% and then selects the prediction with the highest probability. In RL terms, this would be Wallace's best predicted action based on the Q values. This prediction is then used as input for the error function. The error function, which is commonly referred to as a loss or cost function, determines the accuracy of said prediction. Now, it's very common to calculate the loss with a mean squared error equation, which is just the difference between the predicted and the actual square divided by the number of participants. Backpropagation, represented by this purple line, is how a neural network learns, and is actually what I was alluding to before. When the neural network learns by taking the derivative of the loss function and uses it to update the weights at each update cycle. Again, the graph at the top is known as gradient descent, and it illustrates the trajectory of the loss. The ultimate goal is convergence, which means we want our temporal difference loss to be as close as possible to zero, the global minimum, because we have a very high prediction accuracy. So to put this all together, each epoch, which is just an iteration in neural network speak, trains a model on a very large data set to make better predictions. And then that trained model is evaluated against a test data set. At this point, you would continuously make refinements to the hyperparameters or the model itself, then retrain and evaluate again until the model can consistently make accurate inferences on production data it's never seen. Meaning on deep neural network convergence, Wally has just used the Bellman equation to identify the best MDP Q values for the optimal policy. In deep Q learning, we can reference Wally's state as a position on a graph and use it as input for a neural network. It's important to note that we primarily use mini-batch gradient descent in reinforcement learning, which means we periodically update our target Q values within an episode instead of waiting for the episode to end or after each action taken. Not only does this allow Wally to understand how to behave overall, but also during rare nonlinear scenarios. Experience replay refers to how Wally would collect the data for mini batch gradient descent by remembering past experiences and then sampling a batch of memories to predict how to behave moving forward. An experience, which is also referred to as an observation, is just a tuple of the current action, the received reward, the received next state, and a terminal state Boolean. I know there's a lot of information taken, but it'll make our demos much more efficient and understandable. The Atari Lunar Lander game is an ideal RL simulation because it shows off these complex concepts in a very simplified manner. Our agent has three main functions. One, taking actions under an epsilon greedy action selection policy. Two, remembering experiences and storing them to memory for experience replay. And three, learning from the experiences of trial and error. When implementing DeepQ learning, we often use a variation called double DeepQ learning, which means we employ two separate neural networks to identify the best Q values. One is an online network, and the other is a target network that handles the Q value policy. Now, the online network is still used to take all the actions and build up experience. But the target Q values in the next state are taken from the target network, whose weights are based on an online tracking of, or sorry, not online, or whose weights are based on a stabilized tracking of the online network's weights. When calculating the temporal difference loss, the desired target predictions are no longer being constantly influenced by short-sighted actions in a stochastic environment. Emphasis on the word constantly. Employing two serial networks, where'd it go, helps eliminate a maximization bias inherent in DeepQ learning that at worst prolongs the training time and may actually result in a single neural network taking this same short-sighted actions over and over again. Picture yourself trying to catch a like-minded moving target, and each strategic adjustment that you make focuses on immediate gratification instead of the long-term result. Now, I'm using the Keras library with a TensorFlow backend to instantiate a sequential model. This neural network that I've composed takes in an array of standardized images. Each game frame serves as an agent state. Now, since the Atari Lunar Lander game environment really isn't all that complex, and we have a small set of discrete actions, up, down, left, and right, our neural network really doesn't have to be all that complex. It just needs a few dense layers to identify patterns and map states to actions. We then compile the model with an atom optimizer, specify the learning rate to improve performance, and use the mean squared error loss to improve the prediction performance. So to put this all together, the process starts with the agent familiarizing himself with the environment by taking actions and then storing those experiences into memory. The agent will then call the learn method after each action taken to identify patterns for the online network. After the online network has collected X amount of experiences, the agent will actually update the target network's weights with a copy of the online network's weights. Now this process continuously repeats itself. And after training on 500 episodes in a stochastic environment, the agent's performance shows noticeable improvement. This process takes a very long time though, so I just video captured and sped up the results. Enjoy.
So now we're going to take the concepts we just learned and see how they can be utilized in a cloud environment. I've chosen AWS because it's arguably the most mature cloud provider in the market. So what are the benefits of using AWS for fast machine learning? In its simplest form, Amazon Web Services is a virtual data center provider, also known as a virtual private cloud. It allows us to securely consolidate all of our files and applications onto a VPC so that we can easily access them from anywhere, and most importantly, scale on the demand of our computational needs. Please note that even though there are numerous upsides to using AWS, it can come at a significant financial cost. In regards to that upside though, the primary benefits of using AWS for machine learning development are: one, it offers a broad array of computation for model training and inferences with GPU and CPU based EC2 instances. If you don't know, an EC2 instance is just a virtual server that can run an application. Per the AWS shared responsibility model, it is the responsibility of the customer to manage the operating system and security configurations of their EC2 instances. We want that flexibility. There are trade-offs to consider, like speed, reliability, and cost when selecting graphic processing units over central processing units for our EC2 instances. And just to confirm, you guys can see me, correct? Perfect.
Everything seems fine.
Perfect. Generally speaking, GPUs are a safer bet for fast machine learning because, as we saw, neural networks are composed of matrix calculations, the speed of which can be greatly enhanced if the calculations can be carried out in parallel, meaning that CPUs are best at handling more complex calculations sequentially. Another benefit is that even though AWS has developed a fleet of its own machine learning services that work out of the box, it has also natively integrated the major machine learning frameworks and libraries like TensorFlow and Apache Spark to allow customers to build custom machine learning applications via the SageMaker console. SageMaker is Amazon's premier machine learning service, and it's really come a long way. Just this past December at reInvent, they announced the SageMaker Studio IDE that aims to unify all the features needed for machine learning development. Features like SageMaker Experiments allows us to organize, track, and compare thousands of machine learning jobs, like training, feature engineering, or model evaluation that work in conjunction with SageMaker processing. Now, I personally haven't had the opportunity to use it yet, but hopefully one of the bundled features is SageMaker RL. To train an independent model with SageMaker RL, all you need is a deep learning framework like TensorFlow, an RL toolkit that manages the interactions between the agent and the environment, and an RL environment, which can be open source, commercial, or I can't think of the third one, but it's a really dynamic application that actually gives you all the tools that you need for RL development, which is super useful. In addition to SageMaker, many of the other machine learning services deeply integrate with the rest of the platform to allow customers to build end-to-end pipelines. For example, if you want to build a machine learning security pipeline, monitor the logs for compliance or model troubleshooting. A specific use case is how the Amazon MAC service first establishes a baseline of user data behavior, and then uses natural language processing to identify any unencrypted P2 data stored in an AWS account. P2, if you guys don't know, stands for personally identifiable information, like credit cards. We'll then pass these flagged events to CloudWatch, which can invoke a custom Lambda function for notification or remediation. Highlighting Amazon Macy's capabilities seem particularly appropriate given the national spotlight on data leakage. From a commercial standpoint, the video I'm about to play showcases how the Amazon Lex service can be used to build an RL pipeline for the hotel booking flow process. The pipeline starts with Amazon Transcribe, converting customer speech into text, and then piping that into the Lex chatbot service. In this scenario, the environment would be the conversation itself, but you could also build a virtual environment with the Amazon Sumerian service. The states that Lex would transition between would be represented by the flow of the conversation. The actions would be a list of defined responses that Lex can take given the state of the conversation. And the responses from Lex can then be read back to the customer using Amazon Polly. This back and forth between the customer and Lex would allow us to measure the rewards, which would be based on customer sentiment that could be calculated with Amazon Comprehend. Most importantly, SageMaker be used to train and validate an RL model that uses custom user flow to calculate the values of the states, actions, and rewards. And let me play that video.
Hello, my name is Christine and I am a Sumerian host. How can I help you today? Hello, my name is Christine and I am a Sumerian host. How can I help you today?
Hi, Christine. Can you book me a hotel?
What city will you be staying in?
New York.
What day do you want to check in?
Tuesday.
How many nights will you be staying?
3 nights.
What type of room would you like, queen, king, or deluxe?
Deluxe.
Okay, I have you down for a 3-night stay in New York starting the 3rd of April 2018. Shall I book the reservation?
Yes. Thank you, Christine.
You are very welcome. I'm glad I could help.
So to conclude this technical session, we can use reinforcement learning to train agent to make decisions on its own that yield the highest rewards and the completion of the goal in a dynamic environment. The Markov decision processes is a framework for making these conditional decisions using states, actions, and rewards, which can be optimized with the Bellman equation. Finally, DeepQ learning is an MDP strategy that uses a deep neural network to take in a batch of states in order to predict and exploit the best set of actions that produce the desired results. Consistently producing the desired results can be achieved at scale to maximize security and customer satisfaction with a cloud environment. The concepts we just learned are extremely complex once you get into the details, but I honestly believe anyone with a burning desire to learn this material is capable of doing so. It just takes time. I've aggregated some beginner-friendly resources that I'd be more than happy to share with anyone that's interested. I hope this lecture inspires y'all for the capabilities of reinforcement learning, because it'll definitely have an impact on our future. Does anyone have any questions?
All right, so for Q&A here, we have a couple choices. Everyone has the ability to unmute if you would like to ask a question. We have the chat on the side here, and a few of you communicated with me, but it was mostly about the audio. So Enzo, why don't you turn your video on, and let's see if any questions come in.
Yeah, you got it.
All right, and maybe just I'll prompt you with one or two if you don't mind.
Yeah. No problem.
So there are some downloadable environments. You had them there in your one of the slides. There's OpenAI, the OpenAI Gym. What are some of the others? And do you have any recommendations of which one to start with?
I would definitely use OpenAI Gym. It's very, very versatile, and it actually If you guys are interested in game environments, then it actually manages all of the set of actions, so you don't have to define the actions yourself. You can just play around and with the concepts. And then there's also like a baseline RL, and then like Chris had mentioned, Amazon has its own environment offerings via SageMaker RL, and also the application that you had mentioned earlier, which was new to me. But I would definitely start with OpenAI Gym.
And so you used deep Q learning as your learning technique. What other approaches are there that you've used that you think are helpful and worth looking at?
So this was introduction to reinforcement learning. Deep Q learning is even though it's a very robust application, it's nowhere near the cutting edge. I would definitely say once you familiarize yourself with these core concepts, then you can like any principle, you can venture off into different directions. You could use policy gradients. You could use what I'm actually learning right now, which is the rainbow method, which is actually based off of Q learning, and you're just adding more enhancements similar to double deep Q learning, where like you use a dueling architecture, which just means that, in short, you're splitting the Q values between an advantage and value function, so that you'll know, okay, there are inherently good and bad states to be in, regardless of the relative advantage of the actions in these states. But going back to the point, there are you can keep going. You can the advantage value or advantage factor critic policy. That's a good one. AC2, AC3. There are more ways to build on top of this.
Got it. I don't see any questions from our members here. I'll just ask you one more, but please, if there's anything, please do either post it on the chat or interrupt me and Enzo. Looks like Lee may have a question.
I do. Hopefully you can hear me okay.
There we go.
Yeah. Hey, yep. Enzo.
Yes, thanks. Loud and clear. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Enzo, for your talk. I just wanted to perhaps get a little bit of clarification on the example that you gave with the lunar lander. So if I understand correctly, it's taking in, sort of like the current state. Is that drawn from, say, like a set of inputs from an image that you're representing, or some sort of feature description of that landscape that you're trying to land the lunar on? And then is the network, so specifically looking at the DeepQL, is the network then the output layer of that network? Is that, for instance, a series of, you know, engine controls or something like this, thruster controls or something like that to land it? Is that what you're actually modeling in terms of input and output on your net?
So the neural network takes in an array of images, like I had mentioned. That whatever you saw during that video clip, so each game, each frame is a state. Now I could have optimized that and converted that that neural network into a convolutional neural network, which I probably should have done to compress the images, but it's basically just filtering out for patterns and saying, okay, when the agent is in this matrix, it's the rewards are not good. But then when the agent is in between these two poles, the rewards are higher. So the output is actually the set of actions. So up, down, left, right.
Right. Right. Okay. So, okay. Cool. So you've got your image as your input to your net. You've got your actions, which are the up, down, left, right sort of actions on the output of the net. And then your reward function, as you say, is sort of setting that distance between the two poles.
Right. Which says, okay, if I take a right from where I am, is the reward going to be better or worse?
Yeah. Got it. All right. Thank you.
That just optimizes the weights.
Thank you.
Great. Hey, just one more question, if you don't mind, before we go. You mentioned a few Greeks here, lambda, epsilon, etc. We have our learning rate, episodes, which is the equivalent of epochs. What do you find are the most influential hyperparameters? And when you're tuning, what do you have an approach?
So I would definitely start. My approach is you just start with the hyperparameters. And the two big ones that really seem to, at least in my experience, have always been the epsilon and batch size.
And okay.
Is this still kind of, I haven't really fully grasped how this works, and I haven't got into the details of the math, but when your batch size is smaller, it actually has a better chance of getting out of these local minimums to find the global minimum. And I can't recall off the top of my head why that is, because it's very counterintuitive, but that's why stochastic gradient descent seems to work fairly well. But again, we can't use stochastic gradient descent because we need to be able to adapt to rare situations. So the smaller the batch size, or the smaller the mini batch size, it seems to be better, but you don't want it too small, so you have to find that right spot.
Got it. So many things in deep learning are counterintuitive, like dropout and annealing learning rates.
This is true.
Enzo, I'd like to thank you very much. This was an excellent introduction to reinforcement learning. I hope you can come back and present again sometime. Do you have any closing comments?
No, I just I want to thank you guys for all your time. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I hope that I inspired at least one person to take up the material. And again, I am so sorry about the audio issues. I thought that having the headphones would actually remove some of this ambiance noise, but it actually just ended up backfiring. But again, have a good night and thank you for your time.
Yeah, I think you're getting a round of applause from the team here. So thank you, Enzo. Cheers. And thank you, everyone. We're going to try to do this at least once a month again. Tell your friends and family. I mean, there's no geographic restrictions anymore. There's just no free pizza from Arturo's either. So thanks again, everyone. We will see you at the next New York City Deep Learning Meetup. Oh, are the slides available? Lisa asks.
Yeah, I just saw that. I would be more than happy to share them with you. I can send it to Chris, or you can find me on LinkedIn. It's whatever is easy for you guys.
I will definitely post them with your permission. I'll post them on the Meetup page. I'll post the video on YouTube. We'll do a little editing to clean up some of the gaps, and we'll throw the audio in. So like I said, hey, this is a learning experience, a reinforcement learning experience for all of us. All right, cheers. Thanks again, Enzo. Change yourself and thrive. Will we survive? Cybermetric hand trip on a backflip. Molotov matchsticks with Vernon Calabasas. Thanks to clowns to be seen wrapped in the shroud.